Good afternoon, jazz music fans. You've been listening to the incomparable Duke Ellington's Take the A Train. Duke Ellington, born Edward Kennedy Ellington on April 29, 1899 in Washington, D.C. Good afternoon and welcome, students, parents, guests, and faculty and staff of National Dance Institute New Mexico. My name is Charles Lowry, and I will be your guide for this afternoon's presentation of the history of jazz giants. And this first day of April is also the first day of National Jazz History Month 2023. Yay. I am joined here today with some remarkable musicians and music educators. Sid Finley. Casey Whitney. And the renowned Zenobia. Today we will explore the music's meanings and its applications in West African culture and its migration to the Americas. We will touch on jazz's early beginnings as chants, field hollers, and work songs while highlighting some of its earliest pioneers and mid-century giants who moved the movement. As it progressed from juke joints to jazz clubs and concert halls to international jazz festivals. And lastly, we will talk about some of the contributions and challenges of jazz giants, their influence on the world culture, and their larger impact on the African-American experience. History suggests that some of the basic elements of jazz music originated from the Yoruba tribe in West Africa, tracing its origins in southwestern Nigeria as far back as the 6th century. The Yoruba tribe was part of one of the largest ethnic groups in Nigeria and on the African continent. Spreading through the African diaspora, Yoruba heritage made important contributions to the cultures of Cuba, Brazil, and the United States. The Yoruba people are best known for their highly advanced drumming techniques and traditions using the gongong, an hourglass-shaped tension drum, just like the one I have here this afternoon. This drum is also referred to as the talking drum, which was used to imitate conversations and vocal music to send messages such as news about ceremonies and to communicate commands over distances of 4 to 5 miles. Yoruba folk music has heavily influenced the music of Cuba, Afro-Latin, and Afro-Caribbean music styles. Enslaved Africans carried this music and its traditions with them to the Americas, in their heads, their hearts, and in their souls. These enslaved Africans preserved their music against all odds in the plantation culture of the Americas, particularly in the American South. The music incorporates the polymetric and polyrhythmic sounds, which uses two or more meters and two or more independent rhythms simultaneously. This evolved into the chants and field hollers on the cotton plantations, the work songs on the railroads, rivers and levees, and hymns and spirituals. Rhythms and rituals, rhymes and spirituals transformed into gospel, and blues.
Ethel Waters was an American singer and actress. Waters frequently performed jazz, swing, and pop music on the Broadway stage and in concerts. She began her career in the 1920s singing blues. Some of her notable recordings include Dinah, Taking a Chance on Love, Am I Blue, Cabin in the Sky, and her version of His Eyes on the Sparrow. Waters was the second African American to be nominated for an Academy Award and the first African American to star on her own television show, and the first African American woman to be nominated Primetime Emmy Award. Stormy Weather is also one of her notable recordings. Keeps raining all the time. Life is bad, gloom and misery everywhere. Stormy weather just can't get my poor self together. I'm weary all the time, weary all the time. When he went away, blues walked in and met me. Oh yeah, and if he stays away, old rocking chair's gonna get me. All I do is pray. Walk in the sun once more. Can't go on. All I have in life is gone. Stormy weather. Since my man and I ain't together, keeps raining all the time. Her 1933 recording of Stormy Weather was listed in the National Recording Registry by the National Recording Preservation Board of the Library of Congress in 2003. Little late, huh? Gospel Music Hall of Fame, 1983. Christian Music Hall of Fame, 2007. Commemorative Stamp, U.S. Postal Service, 1994. Nomination Best Supporting Actress Academy Award, Pinky, 1949. Nomination Outstanding Single Performance by an Actress in a Series, Primetime Emmy Awards for Route 66, Good Night Sweet Blues, 1962. And three recordings by Waters were inducted into the Grammy Hall of Fame.
Right about now, I think we need to wade in the water. For most early jazz musicians, the only places to perform were the rudimentary, isolated, and segregated juke joints. The term juke is believed to come from the Gulliver juke or jug, meaning rowdy or disorderly, and derived from the Wolof word from Senegal, Mauritania, and the Gambia, juke, meaning to misconduct oneself. Juke house or juke is the slang term for a less than formal establishment featuring music, dancing, gambling, and drinking, primarily operated by African Americans in the southeastern United States. Juke joints were situated at rural crossroads and catered to the African American worker who emerged after emancipation. Plantation workers and sharecroppers needed a place to relax and socialize following a hard week, particularly since they were barred from most white establishments by Jim Crow laws. If any of you saw the movie The Color Purple, you saw Harpo's Place. It's a classic juke joint. The world of jazz encompassed so many early pioneers, like Jelly Roll Morton, W.C. Handy, Big Spiderbeck, Sister Rosetta Tharpe, Buddy Bolden, Sidney Bechet, Scott Joplin, King Oliver, Louis Armstrong, Bessie Smith, Sweet Emma Barrett, Jimmy Rushing, Lieutenant James Reese Yerk and the 369th Infantry Hellfighters Band, and many, many more, most of whom were little known or obscured from history. Now, let's listen to one of my favorites and one of jazz's most beloved pioneers, Louis Armstrong.
I'm not exactly Louis Armstrong, but...
but I can talk.
So most people think of Louis Armstrong as the person who invented jazz. But if you were born in New Orleans like he was, you know the real father of jazz was cornet player Buddy Bolden. Bolden was born in 1887, and that was a long time before records and movies. But as a young man, Satchmo or Pops, Armstrong had many names, saw him play, and he said that without Buddy Bolden, there'd probably be no Louis Armstrong, and maybe even no jazz. Give me a kiss to build a dream on, and my imagination will thrive upon that kiss. Sweetheart, I ask no more than this, a kiss to build a dream on. Oh, give me a kiss before you leave me. My imagination will feed my hungry heart. Leave me one thing before we part, a kiss to build a dream on. You all know Sid.
Themselves and their music incorporated into the cultural landscape, but that was not as widely nor readily accepted as we will hear about as we proceed. By the 1940s and the 1950s, we find ourselves in the midst of these jazz giants who are moving the movement. Duke Ellington, Charlie Parker, Tommy Dorsey, Thelonious Monk, Max Roach, Earl Hines, Ray Charles, Cab Calloway, Billy Strayhorn, Glenn Miller, McCoy Tyner, Count Basie, Ella Fitzgerald, Fats Domino, Dizzy Gillespie, Nina Simone, Mary Lou Williams, Lester Young, John Coltrane, Alice Coltrane, Benny Goodman, Dinah Washington, Nancy Wilson, Nat King Cole, Billie Holiday, Sarah Vaughan, Betty Carter, Shirley Horn, Colin McRae, Miles Davis, and too many more to mention. Right now, let's listen to the one and only Ray Charles.
Ray Charles' music curiosity was sparked at Wiley Pittman's Red Wing Cafe at the age of 3, when he heard Wiley Pittman play the boogie-woogie on an old upright piano. He taught Ray how to play the piano, and by the age of 7, Ray was totally blind, and his mother searched for a local school that would teach a young black and blind student. Ray's journey had taken him to too many places, stages, record labels, and situations to mention here. The song Georgia on My Mind, written by Hoagy Carmichael and Stuart Burrow, in 1930 became a major hit for Ray Charles in 1960. During those times, Ray, born in Albany, Georgia, had refused to perform in front of a segregated, all-white audience. The promoter sued him for that position against segregation. Since Ray often returned to Georgia to perform throughout the 1960s, 70s, and in 1979, the state of Georgia honored and issued a formal apology to the musician and composer, Ray Charles. The state legislator completed the finality when his version of Georgia on My Mind was adopted as the official state song. Achievement Award in 1987, and 10 of his recordings have been inducted to the Grammy Hall of Fame. 2022, he was inducted into the Country Music Hall of Fame, as well as the Black Music and Entertainment Walk of Fame.
I think right about now, I'd like to hear a little bit of Ella Fitzgerald.
Before we do that, I toured with Ray Charles. I was what they called a Raylette, so one of his background singers back in the day. Long, long time ago, before you were born, your parents might not have been born. When Ella Fitzgerald was young, she got in so much trouble ditching school that she was sent to a girls' reformatory. Once she started singing, people loved her voice, but she didn't know how to dress or do her hair to be glamorous, so she missed out on a lot of gigs. So when your mama tells you, you know, you really going out like that? Think about it. But band leader Chick Webb hired her because he saw a diamond in the rough. But don't feel sorry for Ella Fitzgerald. She's been considered the gold standard of jazz singers for 50 years. She wrote this song when she was in Chick Webb's orchestra, and it was one of the biggest selling records of that decade.
From the album said, no, I'm that old.
Enough Said, that became a surprise hit for Simone, reaching number 2 on the UK singles chart and introducing her to an audience, making Feeling Good a well-known tune. Many folks do not know that it did come from a Broadway musical, The Roar of the Grease Paint. Birds flying high, you know how I feel. Sun in the sky, you know how I feel. Reach drifting by, you know how I feel. It's a new dawn, it's a new day, it's a new life for me. And I'm feeling good. In the sea, you know how I feel. Ripple running free, you know how I feel. Blossom in the trees, you know how I feel. It's a new dawn, it's a new day, it's a new life. It's a new dawn, it's a new day, it's a new life. It's a new dawn, it's a new day, it's a new life. Nina Simone was a recipient of the Grammy Hall of Fame in 2000 for her interpretation of I Love You, Porgy. She was inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame in 2018. 2 days after her death in 2003, she was awarded an honorary degree by the Curtis Institute of Music, the very music school that had refused to admit her as a student at the beginning of her career. In 2018, she received a nomination for Best Rap Song as a songwriter for Jay-Z's The Story of OJ from his 4.44 album, which contained a sample of Four Women by Simone. It's a very important song to check out. She was inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame by fellow R&B artist Mary J. Blige.
Growing up listening to a whole lot of jazz music at home, one of my favorites, and was also a favorite of my mom, Nancy Wilson.
So I'm gonna do a little bit of a departure here, because Nancy Wilson was a personal friend of my family's. And although she was a huge jazz fan, she preferred to be called a song stylist. So, if you get a chance, listen to her songs, because it's a little different than what you would, a typical jazz song, right? Because she put her own little flair into everything. Miss Nancy was a 3-time Grammy Award winner, a National Endowment for the Arts jazz master who recorded more than 70 albums. Nancy was one of the first African Americans to have her own TV show, The Nancy Wilson Show, which won her an Emmy. I wish you bluebirds of the spring to give your heart a song to sing, and then a kiss. But more than this, I wish you love. you guys. Miss Nancy told me I had a voice made for ballads. In March 2018, 40 years later, I did a tribute concert to her at the African American Performing Arts Center, right down the street here in Louisiana. And during that concert, she sent me flowers. Oh, it's like giving me chills right now. I almost brought tears to my eyes. She passed away 9 months later. If you have a teacher who tells you that you have something special, listen. They may be onto something. Let's do a little, let's go back to My Breaking Heart and take it out.
At the age of 15. Then she began performing in clubs. Later, it was suggested to Ruth by the owner of the nightclub she sang at that she change her name to Dinah Washington. Primarily a jazz vocalist, she performed and recorded in a wide variety of styles, including blues, R&B, and traditional pop music, and gave herself the title of Queen of the Blues. In 1959, she had her first pop top 10 hit, which garnered her a Grammy Award with a version of What a Difference a Day Makes. What a difference a day makes. 24 little hours brought the sun and the flowers where there used to be rain. Were mine. What a difference a day makes. There's a rainbow before me. Skies above can't be stormy. Since that moment of bliss, that thrilling kiss, it's heaven when you find romance on your menu. What a difference a day makes. Dinah Washington died in 1963. In 1986, she was inducted into the Alabama Jazz Hall of Fame, the Grammy Hall of Fame, and into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame as early influence. In 1993, the U.S. Postal Office issued a Dinah Washington 29-cent commemorative postage stamp.
And I think up next we have a lady who was affectionately known as Sassy, Miss Sarah Vaughn.
Yeah. She was Sarah Vaughn, but most musicians just called her Sassy, or even the Divine One because of her onstage style and 3-octave range. She got her start winning a talent contest at the world-famous Apollo Theater in Harlem. Sarah, Billie Holiday, and Ella Fitzgerald practically created the style of jazz singing. She sang at the White House at Carnegie Hall, was inducted into the Jazz Hall of Fame, had 2 Grammy Awards, even though she was nominated for 9. She was an NEA Jazz Master and has a star on the Hollywood. They all have stars on the Hollywood Walk of Fame. They all have revenue. as well. She was even an actress starring in three movies. I'm gonna sing her classic, All of Me.
Other musical styles and genres. Hip-hop and rap artists sampled Miles Davis's music. Many Western swing bands owe their style to Duke Ellington's big band sound. Jazz has leveled the playing field for women, enabling them to showcase their talents and establish equal footing amongst their male counterparts. Witness the influence of Cab Calloway. He had on the zoot suit wearers in the 1930s and the 1940s and beyond. And who can forget how Miles Davis's clothes he wore influenced generations of young black men, including me. A first for black jazz musicians, the Nat King Cole Show premiered on NBC on November 5, 1956. Initially, a 15-minute program broadcast Monday nights from 7:30 p.m. to 7:45 p.m. It was the first black-hosted television show. Jazz music has helped break down racial barriers and has been used as a tool for political activism. During the civil rights movement of the 1950s and the 1960s, many jazz musicians used their fame and recognition to speak out against racial injustice and segregation. Jazz music has had a significant impact on education in this country. Since the early 1900s, jazz bands have played a profound role in the lives of junior high school, and college students. Jazz music continues to be a powerful force for change in American society, promoting understanding, cooperation amongst all peoples. Now, we're gonna open the floor for a little Q&A, a little discussion. Before we go further, how do you like things so far? Was it good? Better than it ever was.
I'm doing stage work, I'm sorry.
Oh, hello.
We've been doing it for about 42 years. That's all we've been doing. So it was not about me. It was more about Jesse Dubois and a couple of musicians and music educators that on staff here, or on faculty, I guess, here at Indiana, New Mexico. Todd Lowry, no relation, spelled last name, spelled differently. And my longtime friend and music impresario, I should say, Steve Figueroa, they, I guess, twisted Jesse's arm and said, "You need to call Charles Lowry, he knows everything about jazz." So Jesse reached out to me, I reached out to my friends, and we put the narration and the script together, and they did the hard work, putting the music on the pages. And
a show was born.
And a show was born, right. So you, thank you. So we premiered this in front of you all because we know how easy, no. We don't know who we're going to go with this, to be honest. We've talked briefly about maybe we ought to take this on the road, but we'll see what happens. What I would really like to do is to see how we can incorporate some of you all, you youngins, in this, because I think to the credit of what we are trying to do today, in terms of helping the community to understand the legacy, the history, the contributions, the challenges that many of these musicians faced. You all have a little easier road, but let's be clear. If we forget from whence all this came from, then we won't know really. We'll have a little pathway in terms of going forward. So being in a place to be able to pass the torch and engage younger people like you all, I think that's something that is certainly worthy of consideration. So stay tuned. Come on, more questions. I know you guys have questions, because there he is.
That's inside of me, and I would say that probably for all professional musicians, because once again, music is inside of all of us, but the professional musicians, I think the music is just screaming to get out of you, so you can't hold it inside. So I think that's the biggest motivator of all, unlike today where everybody wants to be, what are those TV shows?
Reality?
You know, what's the big show that everybody wants to be in? America's Got Talent, or those things.
Oh.
So being motivated by wanting to be stars. Well, in our days, we weren't motivated by that because that wasn't a part of the process or the experience. It wasn't like a TV show. You just wanted to sing, and people sang anywhere. You know, in a street corner in the church, and wherever people would allow them in front of their families, people that wanted to sing just sang. And so you were motivated by the love of the music and wanting to get it out of you. What do you think, Sadie?
I agree with you. To add to that, I was raised in a Baptist church, and I sang in the choir. Well, not in the choir, I sang on solos at 5. And this is before they had boom mics, so somebody had to hold me up to the mic. And as I got older, dealing with life issues as a teenager and all that kind of stuff, the Beach Boys lived in my community in Inglewood, California, so I heard them rehearsing there in other people's garages. And I was like, oh, that's interesting, whatever. Beatles came out. And then I can tell you, through Great Depression, not knowing what to do with my life, so let's put it this way, music saved my life. I would not be here today if I had followed my original idea. So I owe music everything.
So, just to add a little punctuation to that question you had, recall all of those enslaved Africans who were brought here on a one-way ticket didn't have any carry-on luggage. They brought the music from here and here. And for decades, nearly centuries in this country, the opportunity to perform, whether it be socially and, God forbid, for money, all of that was suppressed. And so when those opportunities came about to perform, many of those jazz musicians, early blues musicians, they couldn't read music. They had no formal training. They used the instruments that they could either put together or gather, buy for a nickel or a quarter at some pawn shop. And they found a way to express themselves in music which had been suppressed for so many years. And so, like many artists even of today, you look at from whence that creativity comes from. It comes from inside. You just can't read a book or a poster, walk down the street and look at a poster or listen to someone's words and say, well, now I'm inspired all of a sudden. It has to come from in here. And many, almost all of those musicians, especially the early ones, were inspired from within, finding a way to break through and coupling that with their ability to master the European instruments that they did not have access to. They finally had access to these things. So they figured out, well, we can do this, and they did. So
we have a question for you guys. We know that you put together a show, a dance show for jazz. Okay. Is that a question? You're in there. Okay, so let me ask you a question. What's your favorite piece that you're doing? What's the name of the song? It's ragtime. Do you know who the father of ragtime was? His name was Scott Joplin. Go on. So any of the other children that are performing, do you have like anything that is inspiring you about the pieces that you're dancing to? Maybe Take Me to the Land of Jazz or Here Comes the Big Parade?
Miles Davis, your Miles Davis piece.
Miles Davis, I hear.
Yeah, I said it, but that's one of my favorite pieces that they're
doing.
You're
a big kid.
Yeah.
Now, I find it curious, amongst all the jazz tunes that you have listed, I see Every Day I Got the Blues performed by B.B. King. Blues and jazz. I just want you to know I'm a blues singer, okay? Everything came from blues. I'm like that. So blues, what made you guys pick a blues song or whoever picked it, and while you're dancing to it, do you feel anything? An emotion, exhilaration?
Gunner and Raymond, that's the dance you guys are in for the blues piece. How do you feel when you're dancing that piece?
I feel kind of sad.
They're super dramatic in that piece. They're very dramatic, so.
So I have a question. I see one of my favorite groups over the years was Weather Report, headed up by Joseph Zavanula. And I see Birdland is one of the performances, one of your dance pieces.
Everybody.
Who wants to talk about Birdland by Joe Zavanula? Come on, come on. What's it about?
It's our finale, dancers. All of you know it.
Well, I think we're just about out of our time now. We're a little over. I know we're hopefully not holding up anyone, but any more questions? Last call. Yes, sir.
How has jazz inspired you?
In me? Interesting. Okay. So I grew up in Washington, D.C. in the 1950s and 1960s. And my dad, who was a World War II Navy veteran, worked for the city. He had a wood shop in our garage. He was a master cabinet maker. And he would have the radio on up on the shelf, and we would listen to WMAL. And there was a jazz DJ by the name of Felix Grant, and he had the jazz DJ voice. And he would not only play the music, but he would tell you a little bit about each one of those artists that he was playing, just like what we were trying to do this afternoon. And in between me helping my dad and doing what he told me to do, like sweep up the stuff in the floor that he had spilled over from his woodworking, I would be leaning over to the radio and listening to this, and I was just so fascinated. And then on Sundays, of course, the Ed Sullivan Show, many of you don't, I know some of your parents and grandparents know about the Ed Sullivan Show, but back in the 50s and early 60s, it was the only television show where we could see African-American jazz musicians perform. And I'm standing in the living room, and the TV's over there, a small black and white TV. We didn't have color at that time. And I see this guy who, in a suit, tie, trumpet in one hand, and a white handkerchief. And he's playing this trumpet, and he's got this kind of raspy voice. And he's wiping his brow, and he's singing and playing. And I'm mesmerized. And I asked my dad, I said, "Who is that?" He said, "That's Satchmo." I'm like, "What? What kind of name is Satchmo?" And I'll tell you where he got that name from, by the way, if you don't. But I should ask, who knows where the name Satchmo came from? No. Okay. So he said it was Satchmo, and I was enamored. Like many blues musicians and early jazz musicians.
Tell us where it came from?
I am. They all had nicknames. No, they had nicknames. You know, the guys that they played with on the road and toured with, you know, they were all comedians, and they all, you know, practical jokers, but they also, you know, they gave guys nicknames, and it stuck with them. So as Lewis in his early years was playing, you know, the muscles, when they relax in your jaw from playing the trumpet, they sag a little bit here. And for his guys, that looked like a satchel, a bag, a leather bag, satchel. So they shortened it from satchel mouth to Satchmo. There you go. Once again, it's been a pleasure this afternoon, really a pleasure. I want to take this opportunity to thank the faculty and the staff of NDI New Mexico. Thank you very much. A very special thanks to Jesse Dubois and her team for making it happen. I want to say thanks to Travis. He's not here today, but he helped us out last Saturday with our rehearsal. Yes, thank you. And our tech manager today, Davey. Thank you, Davey, for the job you've done. Thank you. And we also want to thank the Music Performance Trust Fund, because without their support, we could not have done this today. So thanks. Thank you so much. And last but not least, a very, very special thank you to these wonderful musicians and music educators who made this happen. Sid Finley on the keyboard. Tracy Whitney. and the lovely and talented immortal Zenobia. I'm Charles Lowry, and it's been a pleasure spending this afternoon with you. Be safe out there and keep swimming.
Thank you.